There was a time when eyewitness testimony was pretty much all the testimony you could have. Eyewitness testimony could be written down, but when it comes to observing phenomena or events, then it still needed to be witnessed and then reported. The idea of swearing to God was a way to have people who understood spiritual principles be more likely to tell the truth, but of course it was no guarantee. Nowadays, eyewitness testimony is considered by the public at large a lesser form of testimony than video footage, and that is why NASA are able to get away so easily with their crimes. People see the footage and hear the testimonies, so no matter the weakness in the personal testimony, no one gets suspicious because the burden of proof has been met by the video footage. I want to use a quote from Simon Greenleaf, who was a lawyer who wrote the laws regarding the rules of evidence for the United States courts. He studied the Bible with a view to ripping it apart based on his rules of evidence and converted to Christianity as a result. He said of the evangelists, "And first, as to their honesty, here they are entitled to the benefit of the general course of human experience, that men ordinarily speak the truth when they have no prevailing motive or inducement to the contrary. So consider the Actonauts. I am certain they have been induced to lie. At the very least, they have had to sign the Official Secrets Act prior to being shown the truth, face a life in prison if they give anything away, or maybe even threats of death to them and their loved ones if they come clean. Certainly for some, NASA may have used blackmail as well. So for the newcomer, weighing the evidence, consider that the actors have every reason to lie, and whilst this evidence may seem weak at first blush, it will grow on you. So let's think very briefly about the post-flight press conference of Apollo 11. Richard Hall paid a testimony expert to analyse the statements from that interview, as well as other statements from the infamous trio. The expert concluded they were lying. I will drop a link for that into the description for further research. The NASA fanboys long ago excused the weird Apollo performance, justifying and rationalising it in their minds by any means necessary, but I tell you, the testimony problem persists. None of the Actonauts I have come across from the shuttle era have given anything like a convincing performance when it comes to describing the experience of what must be the amazing phenomenon of beholding the mighty universe and our wonderful spinning ball. Whilst they do answer the question, and use some descriptive words, they often use the tactic of deflection, stating it is too hard to describe. Sometimes they avoid a direct answer, deferring to video footage or moving off topic. But the descriptions are always utterly devoid of raw emotion, which, given the nature of the achievement and the transcendence of the experience, suggests that something is horribly wrong with their testimony. Sure, not all of them would burst into tears all of the time, but their emotions would get the better of them some of the time, and sometimes what they say is just perverse. So the setup for the post-flight press presentation was different for the shuttle crews. NASA started using civilian personnel and introduced the use of video footage. The huge bonus of the zero-G shuttle was that the extended freefall drops allowed some genuine sharing of the experience of zero-G. They used the video footage to guide them through the presentation and secure good times for the envious reporters, although in some of the presentations there are eerie silences as the crews roll out the same old talking points. Prime footage could be selected for the presentations, and the genuine experience of zero-G, certainly in the early to mid-shuttle era, seemed to come through in some of the presentations. Whereas the descriptions of the spacewalks, for example, were mostly sterile descriptions of functionality and the to-do list they had in their swim tank, rather than experience and transcendence of what should have been, by any reasonable imaginings, a life-altering experience. So here's an example. In this post-flight presentation, the actor is about to recall sticking his head out of the airlock to behold the majesty of the universe. You would think that profound words are bound to follow, however he merely hat-tips the universe and moves into a sterile description of the to-do list in the swim tank.
Exciting moment when you first open the airlock and you look out and there's the entire universe staring you in the face. Now here I am coming out, the first EVA, grabbing onto the manipulator arm while Story is coming out now, and I took a whole bunch of tools on the arm, and the arm is now under Claude's skillful guidance carrying me over to...
A one-off, you may think. So let's try again. In this one, the first female spacewalking actonaut utterly fails to experience any emotional recall in the post-flight press conference as she pops her head out and does not even mention the glorious spinning ball nor the mighty universe. Why, oh why, would you forget to mention the experience?
And this is Dave that you see out in the payload bay already, and this is the first chance I had to stick my head out the hatch on our EVA on day 7 and take a look at the payload bay and get squared away with all our tools.
She literally does not mention it once in the entire presentation. I've clipped and slowed down this image as it pops up for a very brief view in the post-flight press conference. How could you not notice the Earth? This is from Flight 13, so I'm guessing they were experimenting with a new backdrop, but honestly, it looks like if she stuck her hand out, she could touch it. So of course, all she could see was the payload bay while she was in the dive tank. Given how close the Earth is in the post-flight view, I think it would have been hard not to notice. Fanboys, don't worry, I'm not questioning your ability to justify and rationalize this all away. I'm not so foolish as to believe that you're not capable of doing apologetics for your faith.
First chance I had to stick my head out the hatch on our EVA on day 7 and take a look at the payload bay and...
Okay, I'm sure the fanboys see the trick I'm using here. When you go out for a spacewalk, when your life could be ended at any moment and you face the most horrific death, when you behold the mysteries of the universe from outside of the Earth, when you see the lights of the city at night gliding past and you are on the outside of your spacecraft with no window to restrict your view, you do not ever want to try to relay that experience to people. Hard though it may be to hold it in, you can't quite be sufficiently moved by the whole experience to even attempt to describe it. Clearly the trick Dilly Gill is using is that if the experience was just that little bit more spectacular, then and only then would it be worthy of a full description. Let's take a look at the first untethered spacewalk, because undoubtedly that would be worthy of a pause in proceedings and an effort to try to describe the life-altering experience.
Here I am, I guess, backing out to 150 feet, coming back in, and then out to 300 and coming back in. This is approximately the same sort of translation that the folks on the next mission, the Solar Maximum Repair Mission, will be faced with in moving from the orbiter over to the Solar Maximum spacecraft.
I want to show you what undisputable, genuine, first-hand testimony about a significant event really looks like.
One of the high points of my life, and couldn't choose a better place to be. I said I won't get emotional, but I just love it here, you know. People just embrace me and just feels like home, man. And Phillips Arena staff, my guys were there, Coach Ham, everybody. So it just made sense, you know, like, why walk away from something so perfect? And having Wes bring me back, man, it's just, you know, it's not often in this league where you can say you want something to happen and it happens. So when you get to come back, it's just that much more special. And I thank y'all for just embracing.
The organization, just thank you for giving me a chance. Thank you for believing in me. This is a real new beginning for me. And I'm happy to share that, you know, with my loved ones.
And you know, they keep running a lot of guys in, and once they got away from us, they, you know, we keep battling as much as we could. We turned the ball over too much tonight and made some threes late, but the three-pointers and were kind of a difference there for us. And it's a tough battle, but as far as, you know, this game, this series, and this season, I hope you guys all took notice of what happened in the last 3 minutes of the game, because, you know, Matt and Vince, they wanted to finish the game. And I think that's what Grizzlies basketball is about. Those guys are pros, And for what we've been through, I'd do anything for those guys. They've embraced every guy who came in, no matter what their history was. They cared about them. They tried to have them. These guys fought. And I can't tell you enough how proud I am of every guy that is in that locker room and has come through that locker room. This season's been hard. It's been really hard. And I could have quit. Could have quit. Could have not made the playoffs. And every day they came out and they fought like crazy. This was not planned. So I hope as a community, and I know we do, we love our Grizzlies. We love on those guys. And wish them the best as they go forward in their career and hopefully, you know, a long time with us. And that's all I got today. Thank you for a great season.
Here I am, I guess, backing out to 150 feet, coming back in, and then out to 300 and coming back in.
Not once in the history of the 135 post-flight press conferences did anyone say, "Stop the damn tape. I need to tell you how amazing it feels to see what I've seen. I need to share with you the emotions of the day," and then go on a big emotional and descriptive first-hand eyewitness account of what it is to behold the universe and spinning ball. Not once. Sometimes they go a little more in depth to try to describe the alleged experience, but it is always lame and awkward. It would seem that our magical spinning ball and mighty universe provoke no emotion in those that truly behold her. Without the video footage, the eyewitness testimony is garbage. I've heard more emotional and excited testimonies from my son driving home from a Saturday morning football match than I have from an astronaut returning from a spacewalk. Aha, say the fanboys. We've caught you out now. What Dilly Gill is doing here is deceptively holding back the first-hand testimony of being in space while they're actually living the experience. If he would just show that, then we would see some raw emotion and descriptive testimony. Let's take a look then.
What is it like to be in space? What does it feel like?
Well, one of the sensations you can liken it to is being underwater, where you're kind of floating underwater. It's you're free floating all the time, so you don't have a good feel for which end is up. But I mean, so that's kind of physically what it feels like. As far as mentally, I just find it fascinating. I find the whole space exploration program fascinating, and looking out the window at our world is very exciting for me.
I was wondering, what was the most thrilling experience in space that you ever had? What gave you the biggest rush?
I think it was my spacewalk. That I'd have to say, when I went outside in the spacesuit, and when you're outside, here in the shuttle, of course, we still have air. We've got all the comforts of home, but getting into a spacesuit and going outside the shuttle, where there's really nothing between you except for this thin spacesuit, that was really probably the most unbelievable experience that I've ever had.
So this guy has thought about what it might be like to be in space, compared to some of the testimonies from his space diving comrades, which is reflected in his lame testimony. However, his countenance does not change as he recalls this amazing experience. He seems uncertain if this was the best experience, and he describes it as unbelievable, which of course it is, if you study the heliocentric topic and NASA footage for long enough.
Let me just make a further comment about being here. It is far beyond any anticipation that a human being can have. All I dreamed about being in space was nothing compared to what it really is. And every day I just pinch myself and think, this can't be real. I told Jeff and Dave as they came back in from the EVA that I had watched the whole thing from the windows on the flight deck. And all the time I was watching, I thought, this can't be real. I'm not here. I'm not seeing this. This is on TV. And I'm sure after we all get back, we're going to feel the same way. That didn't really happen because it's so spectacular. It's so beautiful to see the Earth from this level and the sunrise and the sunsets and see whole continents go by so rapidly. It really is an unbelievable dream come true for all of us.
I want to focus on the Senator's response to the team being asked, what is it like to be in space? I may do a breakdown of the whole team in a separate video, but for now let's focus on his response. The fact he is included on this mission suggests to me that he has shown flair for the needed skills of an astronaut, namely lying. In this epic moment, he mixes the truth of what's going on around him with the lie of space, and he ends on the lie to sell it to the audience. The other team members are not this accomplished in the art of deception and look genuinely pained and concerned at what he is doing. Now I want to contrast those examples to some genuine, and I use the term genuine very loosely here, interview responses to the activities they actually did. So many of you will recognize this footage from STS-51D. The plotline was that they were to fix a satellite unexpectedly and needed to craft two tools to achieve this. Here we see the two tools they are making, and the instructions are coming from the ground control. I believe they built the two items in something like a team bonding exercise, where they walked around one of the shuttle mock-ups, having only audio instructions and a weird teleprompter diagram for reference from the command center. They were allowed some visual help in the scheduled communication windows, which is what we're watching here, and whilst it was a dreadful plotline, it was a great team building exercise and gave them a genuine experience to share. I will show how this translated into the interview with genuine but selective recall.
This is really for any one of you. We all had to conjure up images of what it looked like up there while you were creating the fly swatters. Was it an arts and crafts class or what? Can you describe the activities inside the cabin while you were doing all that?
It certainly was. It reminded me of either a Girl Scout camp or something similar. We had bits and pieces of everything out.
So can you see how genuine the reaction from all of them was? Far different to the rabbit in the headlights a moment ago. Okay, enough's enough. The last two examples. We're going to listen to some personal eyewitness testimony from Garrett, who was looking very saucer-eyed when he appeared on the Joe Rogan Experience. I'm guessing the fanboys are undisturbed by the evidence from the post-flight press conferences and the personal testimonies live from space, and could be thinking, all the astronauts need is some time to reflect on the experience, and then the opportunity to share. So for those of us who have been paying attention, and know we do not live on a spinning ball, his disappointment at what he saw out the window, which would be nothing, and his preferred position of watching it on TV, is no surprise. This for me is evidence consistent with a fraud. Just before we hear his performance, I want to play this.
It's a scene, man. Memorize it. What? Look, man, an undercover cop's gotta be Marlon Brando, right? To do this job, you gotta be a great actor. You gotta be naturalistic. You gotta be naturalistic as hell. Because if you ain't a great actor, you're a bad actor. And bad acting is bullshit, this job.
Yeah.
What is this? That's an amusing anecdote about a drug deal.
What?
Something funny that happened to you while you're doing a fucking job, man.
Damn. I gotta memorize all this? There's over four fucking pages
Look,
of this
man,
shit.
Man, just think about it like it's a joke, all right? You memorize what's important, the rest you make your own, all right? You can tell a joke, can't you?
Nope.
Well, pretend you're Don Rickles or some fucking body and tell a joke, all right? Nice. Now, the things you gotta remember are the details. It's the details that sell your story.
First view of the Earth from above.
Yeah. Was that right there? Yeah.
What is that like?
Wow. Well, I didn't see it right away because I was in the mid-deck, the downstairs of the shuttle, and there's only one window down there, and it's in the corner, okay? So it's in the hatch, and it's like the size of a dinner plate. And I was up there. You got a lot of work to do as soon as you get up there. So I'm working like crazy. And after about 30 minutes, I see this pale blue glow coming from that window. And I'm like, that's the Earth. You know, I should have a look at that. And I was super excited for this, you know. So I wanted to be ready. So I paused. I closed my eyes. I meditated, you know, call it whatever you want. I just got ready. And when I felt like I was ready, I floated up to that window. And I opened up my eyes and I gazed out for the very first time at the Earth from space. And what that felt like is really, really hard to describe in words. But if I had to pick one word to describe what I was feeling at that moment, it would be meh.
Really?
Yeah, man.
Just meh?
Just meh. I mean, it was all right. It was pretty. It had a lot of like those earth colors, like blues and greens.
Right.
But man, we've all seen pictures of the Earth from space, okay? I mean, we got like HD video coming down from space now, where it's just spectacular. You can see stuff in that video that you can't even see with your own eyes.
Now, luckily for us, he did a spacewalk. However, when asked to describe it, he deflects and does not answer the question. Rather, he talks about how some people react with the fear of falling.
Look at you out there.
Yeah, that's me.
Now, what is that feeling like? Because it's got to feel insane when you're strapped to a space station that's floating around and you're just hanging by a cord.
Yeah. Well, you're holding on tight. And it, you do have that safety tether that you see there. And you know, they can prepare you for everything except for the visual. So when you, like, are in the pool, you're staring at the pool wall. When you get up there and you see the whole Earth below you, some people go out there and get, like, a sense of fear of falling. But, of course, if you let go, you're not going anywhere.
Right.
The space station's moving 17,500 miles an hour, but so are you.
There is a lot of work to be done to fake a mission, and the acting out of scenes creates a degree of realism to the storytelling. Those who excel at lying can travel further up the totem pole of deception and make a very lucrative career out of the entire industry built up to support the lie. Those that do not excel can slide into obscurity. So perhaps he was just trying to be edgy and cool. Let's take a look at our final example, where the tranquil surroundings and the fanboy interviewer sets up the perfect environment for a detailed chair. If you are considering the evidence, indulge me this. It is my opinion that no one has ever sat on the shuttle as it launched, that the launches in the shuttle days were an earthly activity designed to create awe and wonder in the beholder, and set the stage in your mind for the idea that the images shown to you after the launch must be from space. The images from the launch inside the cockpit were recorded on the simulator, and there has never been a third-party independent verification that the launches go to space. Many of the actors do use descriptive words to recall the experience, but none are ever overwhelmed with emotion, and all the descriptions I have heard recalling the launch seem lame in comparison to the event they're trying to describe. So the lady we're about to hear from speaks of her experience, and she claims to have no audio or emotion recollection of the event because she was too busy pushing buttons. This for me is just a type of lying. Rather than getting bogged down in the details she would have to make up, I believe she is just recalling an experience she had in the simulator.
At the point of launch, are you completely absorbed in your operational duties, or does the magnitude of what is going to happen creep in at all? Or are you just too
That's
busy?
A great question. I think you have a couple of hours where you're actually laying on your back waiting. It's actually exceptionally uncomfortable. And so that takes up some amount of your brain power for that amount of time where you are waiting. And so there's some amount of you that's thinking, let's just go already. I'm ready. Let's go. There's also as you get closer in, when your duties require you to start monitoring, your training really does take over. And you are, you know, looking at all of the different things that you're supposed to be looking at, thinking about the next stage, what am I going to be doing next? And so when the stack lights, you're definitely ready for it to go. You know, I'm sure there's a millisecond of, you know, wow, this is really happening. But people have asked me, what did it feel like? What did it sound like? And I find that my memory is, I have a very clear visual memory, but I don't remember other things about how it felt, how it sounded, because I was so engaged in looking at displays, thinking about what was happening.
She then goes on to explain how they had an alarm sound, which I've cut for the sake of brevity. She describes the alarm sounding without any emotion, and an alarm sounding is an experience NASA could easily give her in the simulator. She finishes on this.
But because you have these tasks you have to do, you don't have a lot of leftover to be experiencing it, if you will.
So to sum up, there is no shortage of activity that goes into faking a mission, and because of that, no shortage of experience that can be translated into stories that would have some emotional and psychological memory behind them, although the actor would have to be selective in the memory recall. An example of that would be hanging on the wires in the space lab for an extended period, performing the stunts or motions for the CGI teams to fill in later, or being in the pool performing tasks for the spacewalk footage. Also, they would build genuine camaraderie around the team of people they are faking this with, because that would be a real experience. We can look at the interview footage with Peggy 666 Whitson for an example of that, where she does get emotional talking about her crew. However, that would be in line with the genuine experience of getting to know them over the period of time whilst faking the mission, and possibly a relationship with one of them. What is really hard to fake especially in a live setting, but even in a controlled setting like this interview, is sharing genuine emotions and natural wonder of the experience of beholding the universe and spinning ball from outside of the earth. Some try harder than others, however none ever become overwhelmed about it, nor even give a convincing performance, and all seem keen to get away from the topic or deflect from the topic as quickly as possible. When it comes to sharing the experience of beholding the universe and spinning ball, and what the actors have supposedly experienced, this would make winning a sporting achievement seem like child's play, and would naturally have a huge impact on them. Even with the video footage, the moral responsibility to share, if this were not all faked, and the natural desire to share would become a very common aspect of the actors recalling their experience. We should be sick to the back teeth of them bursting into tears, getting overly excited, and endlessly sharing about the experience. Instead, what we get is perverse, withdrawn, vague, and deflective testimonies.
Was there anything surprising or unexpected about, you said, cleaning filters and vacuuming was
it's not very exciting.
A little unexpected though, but is there anything unexpected or surprising? It could be about the life aboard the STS. I mean, it could be an experience or a feeling or a reflection or...
Unexpected or surprising. You know, you think by I do get asked that question, and I don't have a good answer for it because, like I say, it was, you know, we trained so much, every little aspect. But I don't think that's a bad thing. I mean, I think really the feeling that I had looking out the window at the Earth, watching the Earth go by, looking at the stars, seeing the lightning that we talked about, I can't say that any of that was expected, other than the fact I knew that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to spend some time looking out the window, but experiencing it is obviously pretty unique, and it's hard to express how that makes you feel, but it's a wonderful experience that, you know, I'll sort of have forever those memories.
I'm going to show you the entirety of the internal footage with people in it from the VHS recording system to show the quality and quantity for each mission. Both missions have been sped up to 30 and set to music. STS-51D is set to 80s music and STS-32 is set to 90s music. It would take more mission requests to be able to prove a pattern of fraud, so for now this is just an observation based on the two available missions we have the footage for. My expectation would be that the earlier the mission, the more internal footage there should be from this recording system. I say that because it is lightweight and changing the cassettes is very simple and fast. The desire for operational footage for training purposes and mission review purposes should have been stronger in the early days. Now there is some stocking filler footage and other external activities recorded on the VHS system for both missions. However, I will just focus on the internal footage coverage with people in it from both the missions. The format I received the FOIA requests in was video downlink video recorded in the control room, then VHS system recordings, and then all other recordings including the Arriflex camera. We are just focused on the VHS system. There is no sound in the original for the VHS recorder, and all the crappy quality of the recording is in the original. All the footage from all the cameras in both the missions can be explained by the special effects of their day and the space shuttle being a zero-g plane.
Something, some of them want to use.
That was the title of the STS-51D. Any 80s music fanboys are welcome to express their outrage and fury about the song being cut short in the comments section. I included a bit of a filler at the start for obvious reasons, and I have some filler at the end of STS-32 footage.
Of brown paper, sounds that we bring are of a different nature. Rhythms get greater, and the rhythms they get greater. Yes, another of a tough form for the chaser. New configuration, new riff and new structure, built on the frame that'll hold and won't puncture. Tight, we wrap it up, it's wrapped tightly.
Yes, another rougher tough.